gender is just a representation. On earth is just a representation of the divine goddess. But the male gender too is actually a manifestation of her. So there is no difference. But since there are two different attributes here, and these attributes are always in clash with each other, that is the reason since generations we've tried to suppress the female gender in all cultures. We've tried to suppress her in the ways which you can't even fathom. In certain religious texts, we've just taken her out of the text itself. There is no reference of feminine in the texts. The whole religions have started building themselves up around the masculine only. Because I think somewhere humanity is too afraid of the feminine attributes. She's too raw, she's too aggressive, she's too wild. In a way, she's too complete in herself because she can create. And the whole world is, you know, especially the male attribute is very scared because of that. Do you know as a fact that in the US, US got freed about 250 years ago. Since last 250 years in US after the freedom, there has never been a female prime minister in US. In US, which is considered as the most liberal country on earth. Even Bangladesh had female prime minister, Sheikh Hasina. You know Bangladesh? India had female prime minister. US couldn't do that. 250 years. And look at across the globe, wherever women or females have been heading the governments. Some countries in Europe. Phenomenal success, phenomenal growth. I'm reminded of a very beautiful, I must tell you about this. You know, just before the lockdown, for the first time I went to Central India. There's a beautiful river called Narmada, which is considered a very pious river. Narmada flows through Central India. And there's a very beautiful place called Maheshwar. So I went to Maheshwar with a couple of friends. And in Maheshwar, there's an old fort, palace or fort there, just by the river Narmada, just on the ghats. So I went into the palace. I just wanted to experience, and these are now ruins in a way. So I went into the palace or the fort just to see. The first thing which struck me there, which stayed with me, is a huge statue of a lady. Then I looked around. There were a few beautiful old paintings of the same lady. But the beauty was that this lady was holding a Shivalinga in her hand. All her paintings, all her statues, she was holding a Shivalinga in her hand. I inquired, who is she? And they said, this was the queen of Central India called Ahilyabai, Devi Ahilyabai. I inquired, I was very inquisitive because I've never seen in India a royal lady, all her photos holding a Shivalinga in her hand. I've never seen that in India. I inquired more because I didn't know about this lady. So I inquired more, who is she? Or who was she? So the story went, Ahilyabai was a village girl. She was young, offering prayers in a village temple. When the king of that area, this is about 200 years ago, when the king of that area was passing by, he looked at that young girl and looked at the innocence of the girl and the purity of the girl with which she was offering her services in the Shiva temple. So he requested her parents to marry this girl with his son. Those days, the marriage used to happen at much younger age. So Ahilya Devi got married to this prince. As the luck would have it, so they grew up and everything happened. Then there was a war, and the husband was killed in that war. He was the only young male to head that kingdom. He was killed in the war. After a few years, so once he was killed, she wanted to be Sati. Those days in India, if your husband is killed or dead, you know, you would offer your body on the funeral pyre, you will die with him. That was the culture those days. So she wanted to offer her body on the funeral pyre, but her father-in-law stopped her, didn't allow her to burn herself. So Ahilya Devi started training herself on royal matters, etc. Village girl, remember she was. In a few more years, the father-in-law was also killed. He also died. Now Ahilya Devi had a son and a daughter. After the death of father-in-law, just in a less than a year, the young son also died, who was the hope that he'll become the king. So he's also, all the three male members gone. She's all alone. She came from a village family. Women. Within a short span of time, she took care, she took charge, she took control of the whole center India. If you read the history, which I read, because I was very fascinated by the great power, piousness of this woman. Within a short span of time, that area in central India, Maheshwar became the capital. She did all that which even no current government is able to do. Fascinating. She made sure all the artisans and craftsmen, first of all, in the area thrive. So that segment took off. Then she made sure all the farmers thrive. That segment took off. Now, there were some dacoits in this area. She actually called the dacoits to the palace, made a pact with them, asked them, why do you do this? They said, because we need to survive. She said, okay, I'll give you the land. Start cultivating that land. And I also allow you to tax people who pass through your territory. But minimum tax. You keep all the money, I don't need anything. This is a lady king doing that 200 years ago in India. So those dacoits were like terrorists. She understood their human problem, made them part of their kingdom, part of her kingdom. So this community of dacoits also started thriving. They are called Bheels. So their community also started thriving. Then she moved towards spirituality. All the biggest spiritual centers in India, including up north Badrinath, Devi Ahilya Bai made sure, gave contribution to build roads and the temples there. One of the famous temple in Banaras is built by her. So many ashrams she built, and her objective was that the money which people have, I do not have ownership of that money. It's their property. And she made sure that the taxation remains limited so that she can manage the affairs, that's it. But it is people's money. As government, she knew that it is not her property, it is people's property. And she has no right over people's hard-earned money. So minuscule tax. You read the history, that was the time when the central India thrived. She made pacts with all her enemies. So there were no enemies in the neighborhood now. Everybody became friend with everybody else. Business is thriving. Art and craft is thriving. Spirituality is thriving. All the old women, old people, destitute, orphans, she made sure that they all get the same treatment as any other normal human being gets. No deprivation. Golden rule. 30 years she did golden. She created a golden empire. Power of woman. I thought I'll just share this story with you because these 9 days are dedicated to her. Even now in central India, she's called Devi. In Hindi, in India, we use term Devi for goddess. Ahilya Bai is still considered goddess in India. just because I feel she attained this unity of masculine and feminine within herself. The Shivalinga in her hand, in all the statues, in all the photographs, is an indication that the male and female aspects in Ahilya Bai merged together. That is the reason she also trained herself in the warfare. She did fought a few wars. So as a male, she fought wars. As a feminine, as mother, she took care of entire all the people in her kingdom. Both parts came together. Harmony, oneness, blissfulness. And friends, when this blissfulness happens in your heart, it just not stay there alone. It starts to ripple out. It starts to spread out to other people all around. All living beings start to experience that around you. Yeah. I thought this is a fascinating story about the respect that we gave to feminine in India. I'll give you another interesting before we end this session. Another interesting fact. I was in England last year, met a few friends who were very inspired and who still positively are very inspired to do work for work towards, how should I call that? Something like towards helping women to accept and appreciate their menstruation. Yeah, that's what they were doing. So they were basically finding that there are a lot of women, even in England, who are very suppressed, who do not want to talk about their menstruation openly. And they're very contracted during that time. And they're trying to build a movement there for that, to just help these women out of their, you know, open up their mentality, basically. This is happening now in the West. And I'm not trying to compare, but I'm just trying to, I mean, it blows my mind whenever I think about some of these things. Thousands of years ago, friends in India, we built a temple in Assam, a place called Guwahati, by the edge of Brahmaputra River. If you heard the name of the temple called Kamakhya Devi Temple. You know why this temple is very famous? This temple in India is the seat of Tantra. And you know what is worshipped in this temple? The female yoni is worshipped there. No, the story doesn't end there. The female yoni, the female reproductive organ is worshipped there. That too, when she's menstruating. So in this temple, if you go to the temple and if you look at the entire process, we pray to the bleeding yoni. And this is what is the grandeur of this temple. And hence this has also become a seat of a lot of occult practices. I do not know how old is that temple, but maybe 2, 3, 4, 5,000 years old. This is how in this culture, at one time, we respected, we prayed to the feminine principle. For us, it was not a lesser being or somebody you can manipulate or somebody you can suppress. She was pujaniya. She still is pujaniya, worshipable. Yeah. So she is a doorway through that this oneness, this unity, this Ardha Narishwar can be touched, achieved. Mm-hmm.